Welcome back to the show. Now, value addition, according to several technocrats, has been seen as a magic bullet that could transform and spark growth in the agriculture sector, as most farmers would desist it from selling raw materials and rather invest in processing them. This is the story of African mushroom growers who are currently making jelly and wines out of mushrooms. We visited their plant in Machindye, and here is their story.
Chidu. I'm the managing director of African Mushroom Growers Uganda Limited. We are located along Ruvuma Road in Makindye Division, Kampala. We've been growing mushrooms for the last 10 years, and our company will be celebrating 10 years in June. We are basically mushroom farmers. How do we grow the mushrooms? Mushrooms are fungus, and it doesn't need soil. It actually grows on substrate. The major substrate we use in growing mushrooms here is cotton husks. We actually get the cotton husks and soak it. We take it through a process. The first process is soaking it for a period of about 12 hours. After soaking it, we drain it. Then we mix it with other ingredients like lime. Lime acts as a pH buffer, and once we mix it together with the cotton husks, it makes what we call the substrate. So our substrate is a mixture of cotton, water, and lime. Then from there we pack it to make what most of you know as gardens. These gardens, after packing them, we need to sterilize them, because this fungus cannot be inoculated on something which is not sterile. We have to sterilize the substrate. Now, the way we do sterilization, we use our boiler. Then afterwards, we sterilize it for about 10 hours. After sterilizing, we cool it. Then we plant it with mushroom seeds. The mushroom seeds is what we call the spawn. We put it on both sides. Then after planting, we incubate the gardens. These gardens take a process to colonize, and they take between 15 to 20 days before they can fully colonize. So any mushroom farmer is looking at their garden colonizing, and for them to colonize properly, they must have been sterilized properly and inoculated with good quality spawn. Now, after they have colonized, that's when we move them to the mushroom grow house. From there, they take between 3 to 7 days, then they start sprouting out. After they have, but before they sprout out, you need to water them. You need to keep watering them. This watering helps to reduce the temperature but also increase the humidity. So basically, once you get your gardens, you need to look after them well. How? By watering them daily. That's when they will be able to give you mushrooms on a daily basis. Actually, the business of mushrooms is like you earn daily. So every day, if you have a number of gardens, they'll be producing mushrooms on a daily basis. So this business act in a way that actually this business, you can, just like I've said, you can get daily income. Now, for somebody to be a commercial mushroom farmer, somebody should think about having a space of about 20 by 20 feet. You know, mushrooms, with mushrooms, you don't need require a lot of space. So within that space of 20 by 20 feet, somebody can do commercial mushroom growing from there. That space, once you construct a grow house, that grow house can be able to accommodate at least 1,000 gardens. So with 1,000 gardens, somebody will be able to survive and to depend on those mushrooms. Each garden on the market costs about 3,000 shillings. So for somebody to be able to have 1,000 gardens, he should be able to part with 3 million. So that investment of 3 million will give you about 1,500 kilograms, because each garden has a capacity to give you at least 1.5 kilograms of fresh mushrooms in its lifespan. And the lifespan is 3 months. So within those 3 months, somebody will have harvested 1,500 kilograms from 1,000 gardens. Now, a kilo of mushrooms on the market goes between 5,000 and 8,000. That's how it ranges. But still, as a farmer, when we are cultivating these things, we don't have to use the maximum price. We use the worst price, the lowest price, because sometimes things go down, the market goes down. So if you are to use 5,000 per kilo, you will find that within 5,000, within 1,000 gardens, where you bought 1,500 kilograms, even if you sell at a lowest price of 5,000 per kilo, you will have got about 7.5 million. If you less that money with the cost of the gardens, you will find that you will have a difference of about 4 million. Now, with these 4 million, somebody, if you are to pay yourself on a monthly basis, at least somebody is able to earn at least 1.2 million per month within a small space. You find that this is affordable. Everybody who has a home can create that space, maybe behind his or her house, and build that house and be able to earn an extra income even if you are employed. So really, mushroom growing is a thing. When you look at the market for mushrooms, the middle classes have grown, because many people now have started the habit of, they have started eating healthy. Eating healthy no longer means eating meat. Yeah? People have started eating mushrooms, and the demand for mushrooms is increasing day by day. So you find that these mushrooms are needed a lot in the hotels, in the supermarkets, and in fresh produce markets, even schools. So the demand is growing, but there is also a big potential for export. The neighboring countries need these mushrooms. Congo, Kenya, they need a lot of mushrooms, because currently they are importing from Europe. So we, the neighbors, we can mobilize, we the neighboring countries can embark on mobilizing youth and other people to grow mushrooms, such that we can tap into those markets. Now, mushrooms are not only eaten fresh, we can also do value addition. We can add value on them. Like, for example, here we are making a lot of products out of mushrooms. For example, we have the dried mushrooms, we have the powder, we have the jerries, we have the wines, and this is wine, this is the dry wine, this is the red, sweet red wine, it's all made out of mushrooms. We have the powder. This powder can be consumed in a number of things. You can add it in your sauce. You cook your fish, put 2 spoons of powder to make the soup thick but also more nutritious. You can put it in ginats. You can also put it in porridge. mushrooms are very nutritious. Even if you just make a soup out of it, you find that you will have created a very nice meal, but also nutritious meal. We also have jerry out of it. This is a jerry which you can use on your skin. It's also very good for the skin. We are currently doing a research to see that we come up with a vegetarian sausage, and very soon we shall put it on the market, because we want many people failing to eat sausage because most of them are made out of meat. But we are now, very soon we shall launch a mushroom sausage. I told you the market for mushrooms is huge in the region. For example, in Kenya and Congo, the market is huge, and we need to tap into those markets. But before we begin exporting, we need to work on about three things. One, we need to increase our quantities. You cannot export when you don't have a bigger quantity. You cannot export when you don't have a bigger quantity. Two, we also need to improve on our quality. We also need to be to make the supply sustainable. Okay, so we need to recruit many mushroom farmers into the business. We need to do more training of people, and that's what we have embarked on before we can start exporting. We have decided to add value on our products. For example, we are now making mushroom powders, we are making mushroom wine, we are making the jerrys. We took a deliberate decision because we wanted our customers to have a wide variety of products out of mushrooms. You find that somebody who doesn't eat the fresh mushrooms, at least they can take the powder, they can drink the wine, they can have the Vaseline. So with that, people can consume mushrooms in a different way, and it is creating a lot of demand for it. When the demand is there, it entices more farmers into farming it. Currently, we are the leading producers of mushrooms in the country, and we are working upon improving and taking this industry to another level. We want to engage other farmers and mentor them into this industry. We want to form a strong cooperative for mushroom farmers in Uganda. We want to be taking our products onto the international markets, because Uganda is not known as a mushroom producing country, but in future we want Uganda to be known as a mushroom growing country, because we have the potential, and the market for mushrooms is all over the world. So we are going to put a lot of our energies on improving the systems, on mechanizing the process, and work on the three things: the quality, quantity, and sustainability.
Well, I guess it's then true that as a business person, the time and investment you put into running your business should be able to give you an edge over competitors who who casually conduct their business. Now, it's time for personal finance, and this week we focus on those wondering where to invest their hard-earned NSSF money. Augustine Tamale has the answers.
Hello, Augustine Tamale, my name's, and there is a key issue right now before I continue with our income sources. There is a key issue now of investment that has come up now that we have begun accessing the mid-term funds for National Social Security Fund. We've begun accessing the money. I've met some few people who have received the money. Advice is flying all over on what to use the money for. So that advice, of course, is coming from various sources, and depending on someone's experience and expertise, they direct you towards what they know will be beneficial to you. I have heard the analogy of the securities, that you should go for those financial instruments, that they're the ones which will give you the cash to feed on. Yes, if you are hard up on the funds to utilize, then you can put the money in the treasury bond. Right now in Uganda, the treasury bond, a 20-year one, is having an interest rate of about 17.5%. So just assuming that you got 150 million shillings as your mid-term funds from National Social Security Fund. If you got 150 million shillings and you bought a 20-year bond, which is at 17.5%, then your interest will come to about slightly above 16 million shillings, about 26 million shillings per year. 26 million shillings per year. Now, 26 million shillings, if I did in 5 years, that will give you 131 million shillings. That's what you will be earning, 131 million in the 5 year period. So it will help you if at all your problem is consumption, you need money to eat. But at the end of the 5 years, the value you have is that 131 million shillings as interest, plus the 150 million that you placed in the treasury bond. So that gives you a total of 281 million shillings. That's what you have as a total. But if someone bought a piece of land for 20 million shillings, a small piece, 50 feet by 100 feet, that is an eighth of an acre. If someone bought that at 20 million shillings, then used the 130 million shillings to build either a three-bedroomed bungalow or two small rental apartments, each having 3 rooms in or 4 rooms in total, that can earn rental income of about 400,000 per month. So 400,000 per month, meaning a year 4.8 million, well, that will make 24 million in the entire 5 years. Now, apparently, the one in the fixed, the one who has placed the money in the treasury bond has more money, 131 million for the entire 5 years in terms of the cash they receive. This one has only 24 million. So if your problem is the money to use for consumption, then yes, the treasury bond works. However, if you are not hard up on what to eat, what to spend, what to use in your day-to-day expenditure, then the house is better. You buy the land and build the house, because the value increases exponentially more than this 17.5%. When you buy a piece of land, like in a location in Kira municipality, after 2-3 years, the value doubles. The value doubles. So at the end of the 5 year period, the value has almost tripled. So we are speaking of something like 450 million. If that's the point you are cashing out, then you are much better than the person who has put the money into the treasury bond. So if your problem is day-to-day consumption, yes, the treasury bond is the way to go. But if that's not your problem, when you just want to preserve wealth and grow it, then you go into acquisition of property. In fact, even your children will benefit more when it is property. The value will multiply thereafter. It's going to multiply significantly. Remember, even the other treasury bond money, by the time you get the full amount later, it has been eaten by inflation. Its power is lower. But whereas the value of the property keeps going high. So that's the difference you have to look out when opting for whether you are investing in the treasury bonds or any other financial instruments. I know the unit trusts, they oscillate between 8% to 14% depending on how the economy is running. And then there are other treasury bonds that are lower once you reduce on the period. If you go for 18 years, yeah, then it reduces a bit. 10 years is 16.4%. If it's a treasury bill, then you do a 1 year one at 9.8%. So they keep reducing, and then the fixed deposits are even much lower. For 1 year, it is 8.75%. But if your problem is the cash for use, the treasury bonds are the way to go. Now, if you have much more money, then you can do a mixture. You do both property and then these financial instruments. But otherwise, if you don't have a lot of money, and I know that there are very few people who are getting 150 million and above. So if your money is less, then just make a choice between the two. What is your problem? Current consumption, or you want to preserve wealth and grow it? Then go for property.
If you are one of the people that received their NSSF money, you now know where to go with that advice from Tamale, and you will be able to spend your money accordingly and not go back to searching for money again. Now, the Uganda shilling has maintained a stable trading range against the US dollar over the week as in-month flows from non-government organizations and commodity export give it support. The unit has regained its strength from lows of 3,600 to trade within ranges of 3,590 over the week. Looking ahead, money market experts project that end-month flows should remain healthy, albeit with some continued pockets of corporate demand for dividends, which is likely to keep the unit range-bound. Now, as a business person, your unhappy customers are your best source of learning in business. Criticism should never be a point of distraction, but rather your point of reflection while doing business. Thank you very much for making time to watch the business show this week. We see you Thursday together with the team. Good night.